plenary today is being given by Professor John Horne, who is Professor of History, European History, at Trinity College Dublin, a member of the Royal Irish Academy, and whose research has focused almost entirely over his entire career on various aspects of France and the Great War in a comparative and transnational perspective. Many of you will know his work. His first book was entitled Labor at War and was published by Oxford University Press. He has since published a book on paramilitary violence in Europe after the Great War with Robert Givarth, a companion to World War I with Wiley Blackwell in 2010, Our War, Ireland and the Great War, published by the Royal Academy, Royal Irish Academy, pardon me, in 2008, and German Atrocities 1915, A History of Denial, published by Yale University Press in 2001 and co-written with Alan Kramer. I would like to say that a lot of these books are books which I have been using this year in my seminar at Concordia on film and the legacy of the Great War. So thank you very much, and many of my students are here to hear you speak this afternoon. I've known John for, what did we think, about 25 years?
Longer than either of us care to admit.
Longer than either of us can remember the exact date of. We met in Paris back in the 80s when I was a PhD student. I think John was just beginning his career at Trinity, and we've remained in contact ever since. 2 years ago, he came to Concordia to be external examiner for one of my PhD students, and so the ties that bind Concordia and Trinity have been increasingly tight over the last 2 or 3 years. So without further ado, I would like to introduce Professor John Horne, who is going to give us a plenary lecture today on the topic, the French, a total war, question mark, the French experience of the First World War. Over to you, John.
Merci Norman pour cette introduction plus que flatteuse. Je tiens à remercier la Société for French Historical Studies et les deux co-présidents de cette année, Michel Hébert et Norman Ingram, pour leur invitation, pour leur gentillesse et pour l'honneur qu'ils me font en m'invitant à donner cette conférence plénière dans le cadre de ce très beau colloque. Duquel j'ai déjà tant appris. A total war, question mark, the French experience of the First World War. I'll speak in English for about 50-55 minutes, very happy to field questions in either language. My title has two key terms, total war and experience. Now, total war might seem the more problematic, particularly perhaps in the light of certain debates relating to French history over the last decade. We could debate whether war, or indeed anything, can be total, and if so, what exactly that means. But 15 years ago, I coined the phrase totalizing logic in preference to total war. And this idea has gained a certain currency among some historians of the First World War. By totalizing logic, I mean a set of dynamics which triggered a spiral of reciprocal violence and counterviolence that engulfed more and more of society. Arguably, it was this that gave the two world wars, and indeed perhaps other wars, which gave them their transformative capacity. In other words, from the outset, I think I'm shying away from the notion of total war as a kind of sliding calculus, which gets us having to say in linear progression that certain wars are more total than others, in favor of the idea that perhaps any society at a given time can have a kind of total war. It's just that the nature of it will be historically very different because it will depend on why the constraints on war disappear in that society at that time. And so for this reason, I've preferred the notion of totalizing logic, which tries to get at the processes involved. And I shall try to be specific today about exactly what I mean by these totalizing logics. However, it's the other term of my title that really interests me more, experience. That's the question that I'm really concerned with. The possibility of generalizing about the collective experiences, in the plural, of a population in various settings is for me the key to writing a history of what the war meant for the French, and how they, like others, or maybe differently to them, reacted to its totalizing logics. Experience is social and cultural because it's shaped by values and images. Values and images of how things were, how they are, and how they should be. It is experience, in that sense, deeply normative. But it's also the exact opposite, since experience is where life happens. It's where the unexpected breaks in, for which we have no prior ideas or images. Experience, indeed, is what makes the present different from the past. In order to discuss the French experience of the Great War, I propose to focus on the year 1917, and to do so in terms of three dynamics, if you will, three kinds of totalizing logic. These are enmity, battle, and supply. Enmity, battle, and supply. Why 1917? Well, simply because it was the most troubled, the most contradictory year of the war for the French. It witnessed army mutinies following the failure of General Nivelle's offensive in the spring, the first major strike wave of the war in the summer, and some measure of political turmoil. And yet it brought Georges Clemenceau to power in November as the leader who saw France through to victory of a kind. By using 1917, I hope to show in an exploratory kind of way, and it's related to the work that I'm engaged on at the moment, I hope to show how a history of France's wartime experiences might work, what it could look like to us as historians. By way of conclusion, I shall return to my other term, total war, to see whether we leave the question mark or keep it, to see how, if at all, it applies to France. Now, my first totalizing logic is enmity. And by that, I mean the act of constructing the enemy as an object, as an entity, as an other. This, it seems to me, is a historically very specific process. It differs in the religious wars of the 17th century, the cabinet wars of the 18th century, the revolutionary and Napoleonic wars, or indeed in the ideological contest between Nazi Germany and the Soviet Union in the Second World War. The Great War takes its place in this typology as a conflict of and between nations and empires from which the nation-state emerged triumphant in Europe. Now, national feeling, in fact, turned out to be more powerful than contemporaries had anticipated. And from the outset, it was ideologically colored. Only a minority of the French had considered Germany to be an actual, as opposed to a potential enemy, before 1914. But the July crisis, national mobilization, and the rapid onset of German invasion made Germany the enemy in an absolute sense. Listening to Christopher Clark's terrific lecture yesterday, what struck me was the imminence, and we have talked about this together, the two of us, the imminence before the First World War that all sorts of possibilities were in play. Once the war has broken out, the possibilities which crystallize produce processes which are disproportionate to whatever it was that had caused the war. It's almost, we used a surfing metaphor, it's almost like being caught by a surfer's wave, and the wave simply changes the kind of seascape in front of you. And it was that sort of change which happened to people's mental horizons once the war had broken out in 1914. And it's very important, this point, because it means although there were certain senses of actual or potential enmity before the war, It was with the war and with its outbreak and the immediate events that followed the outbreak that this is really crystallized, becomes a powerful thing in France, but also in other countries as well. Indeed, I think we can explain it by a kind of chemistry. And the chemistry by which this enmity was formed in August, September, October 1914 was complex. It mixed older images of Germany, in the French case, which were inherited from the Franco-Prussian War, but it mixed them with the events of the invasion in 1914. So one finds images, stereotypes from 1870, which resurface, pop up almost overnight. In August 1914, the Germans were supposed to steal a grandfather clocks and wardrobes in 1870, and they're immediately portrayed as stealing the same things in 1914. Kaiser Wilhelm is portrayed as Attila the Hun within 2 days, and Wilhelm I was also portrayed as Attila the Hun in 1870. And yet, the events which happen give a depth and an intensity to this construction of enmity, which is quite new. And those events included centrally the so-called atrocities, the atrocities whereby German soldiers, as we now know, were swept by the illusion, and it was an illusion, that they faced civilian resistance on a mass scale in France and Belgium, and so engaged in brutal reprisals, pillage and arson, collective executions in response to this, which immediately justified the French and the Allies in their own views of talking about German atrocities. This fed the French belief that the Germans had committed major war crimes. In some respects, they weren't wrong. And this kind of image, leur fait d'armes, the way in which they're, and of course it's ironic because faits d'armes are usually concerned with honor and nobility in warfare, but these are the faits d'armes of the Germans in 1914, it suggested, and there was some truth in it, the execution of civilians, but here in the form, of course, of women and children. Because enmity was total, however, and there was a kind of totality to it, the extremity with which the Germans were portrayed as the enemy, the Germans were held responsible not just for these acts, not just for these particular atrocities, but for all destruction caused by the war. Indeed, the war itself, since the Germans were held responsible in French eyes, the war itself was une guerre allemande, a German war. Now, in reality, most of the damage that was caused during the First World War, the physical damage, was the collateral effect of a war based on high explosives invented in the 1880s. Both sides caused it. But in the West, of course, it occurred mainly on French territory. For example, the most famous or infamous example, the shelling of Reims Cathedral, who knows who was responsible for the events that triggered it, and its burning from the 19th to the 21st of September 1914. And so all of the violence of the war, all of the destruction of the war, was laid at Germany's door. It was, in the French perspective, une guerre allemande. The chemistry of enmity was also internal. It drew on different political cultures. Catholics and Republicans agreed to hate the enemy, but they did so in very different ways. Catholics saw the Germans in terms of their own traditions of martyrdom, anti-secularism, and anti-Lutheranism. Here we have an example, a postcard from late 14 or 15, Le Sacre, so the coronation, because of course Reims Cathedral was where the monarchs of France were crowned, and here we have, of course, Joan of Arc maintaining the banner of Catholic and Royalist France with a Kaiser Wilhelm cowering in chains at the foot of the cathedral. Republicans, on the other hand, defended democracy and progress against a Germany which they saw as being both ultra-modern and feudal. And here, of course, the French Revolution was the key reference. Pre-war political cultures helped portray the enemy against whom the war was being fought. It seems to me that the invective and the imagery of the Dreyfus affair were particularly important in this regard. The same invective on both sides was now employed in 1914, only this time, instead of being used by each camp to attack its domestic enemies, both lined up in parallel and projected it onto the Germans. In that sense, the union sacrée, the sacred union, was very much more than a simple suspension of politics. It was a kind of parallel collusion in projecting internal visions of internal domestic enmity now on the external enemy. And since the Germans and the British did something similar, this helps explain the ideological colouring of reciprocal enmity in 1914. It was the externalization, if you like, of the inner political and cultural divisions in nations pursuing different paths of development. And of course, it was formulated as the battle of civilization, diversely interpreted by the French or the British as what they represented, against German Kultur, dismissively spelt with a capital K. And of course, German intellectuals and many others defended German culture against what they saw as being a superficial French or English civilization. We get a good sense of the Republican version of this in these two illustrations from a series produced in 1915 by Ruby, and they are quite simply the lines of the Marseillaise, but put to the events of the previous autumn, the German atrocities. Ils viennent jusque dans vos bras, égorger vos fils et vos compagnes, and there we have the French woman violated and her child murdered, and the Simeon German soldiers stealing out of the door. And then, of course, the obvious refrain is the levée en masse, aux armes, citoyens, with a military Marianne rallying the Republic behind her. They are legion, and I'll return later to this point, the images of the Republic in this sense in 1914. In parenthesis here, I would say that in many respects, I think, that the Dreyfus affair is the pre-run for this, because the development of the notion of the intellectual during the Dreyfus affair and the affair as a war of intellectuals, it seems to me, is scaled up simply to the international level in 1914, 1915. Indeed, the word intellectual becomes used by both sides in Germany and in France to describe it, and the means used are exactly those of the Dreyfus affair. It's the public manifesto signed by men of letters. It's the public exchange, only this time it's not French public opinion, it's international public opinion, which is the theatre. In every sense, this was an intellectual war, a war defined intellectually and therefore ideologically in terms of enmity. And this also explains why enmity cannot be simply dismissed as propaganda, something orchestrated from above, as it was for so long, explained that way for so long. Of course, the media were censored, although this was far from total during the Great War. But the state in the first part of the war was much more concerned with propaganda abroad to win over neutral opinion. What happened at home amounted to a cultural mobilization, or indeed, as I called it, a self-mobilization by many elements in French civic society. It was produced, as one would expect, by intellectuals, churches, Jewish and Protestant, as well as Catholic, by the media and by the political elites. It was disseminated by the media with little centralized direction, but was driven by a powerful consensus. We should certainly not assume that all the population shared this consensus, at least with the same intensity. But the figure of the enemy and the idea that the war was a struggle for the survival of the nation, if not of humanity as a whole, dominated perceptions of the war. And for a total enemy, the only outcome was total defeat. What became of this dynamic of enmity in 1917? We know a good deal about this from state sources, such as the police and the prefects, who, as the war went on, reported on opinion and morale. In a nationwide survey in June 1917, the prefects noted a feeling of war weariness and a desire for peace. This did not mean pacifism. Various currents of pacifism, in a more political sense, did develop during the war, but none was as powerful as the state feared it to be. What the prefects detected was more diffuse, a sense of the horror of the war and a desire for it to end. But this did not mean accepting enemy victory. It was just that the war itself had become problematic. The sense of enmity was dulled and became more relative. And this allowed a language of peace to emerge in parallel with that of victory. In June and again in October 1917, the prefects noted a wave of pessimism, stronger in the towns than the countryside, and in some regions more than others, as to whether the war could be won. It affected the morale of civilians and was reinforced by soldiers home on leave. It was this that made political pacifism potentially dangerous, this substratum of a much more widespread sense of war weariness. The minority current of the Socialist Party, the majority still supported the war effort fully, the minority current of the Socialist Party didn't so much reject the need for the war as develop a discourse based on its horror and on a belief that such disproportionate death and destruction should be resolved by negotiation with the enemy, if at all possible. It both refused to contemplate a peace that did not recognize the territorial integrity of France, Belgium, and Serbia, and yet also declared its solidarity with the working classes of all nations who were the victims, and I quote, of the pain and the death brought about by the global massacre. This was enough for the government to refuse to allow any socialists, minority or majority, to go to the international conference in Stockholm to meet the German Social Democrats. And of course, the conference was in 1917 was abandoned. With fluctuations by region and social class, faith in the war continued to flag through the winter of 1917 to 18. Already in March 1917, a public meeting had been held in the Sorbonne to announce a new umbrella organization, the Union of Great Associations Against Enemy Propaganda, the UGAPE. And the title, I think, is significant. The logic of enmity assumed that any weakening popular commitment to all-out military victory could not be due to the nature of the war, but rather to bad Frenchmen, behind whom stood German spies, German gold, German manipulation. And of course, the answer was to restore and reinforce the stereotype of the good Frenchman, which we see these images d'Épinal of Guy Arnoux doing in a series which he produces in 1918, Le Bon Français se bat pour son pays, and the heroic poilu at the front. And of course, Le Bon Français, the ouvrier is the one qui travaille pour nos soldats in the rear. What followed was a formidable effort to remobilize French opinion in 1917. Dozens of propaganda societies, voluntary but state-funded, were either created or relaunched, and they campaigned by poster, brochure, films, and lectures in different social and institutional circles. No less important, you can well imagine, was the state primary school system, which, owing to its centralized direction and universal reach, was a vital instrument of cultural remobilization. And I think there was also a parallel remobilization which used the parish networks, particularly in some regions of the country, and the power of the church, but also the engagement of local curés. Some of the themes in this cultural remobilization were the same as in 1914-1915, such as the German atrocities of the invasion. But others reflected new events. In April 1916, the Germans, who controlled 2 million people in occupied northeastern France, had rounded up women and girls at gunpoint in Lille and transported them to rural areas to put them to work, and they claimed the reason for this was to solve a severe unemployment problem in the town, or in the city. But in a worldwide campaign, the French government, of course, put the worst possible spin on this affair, girls and young women being rounded up at gunpoint by German soldiers. When the Germans staged their withdrawal to the fortified Siegfried Line in March 1917, when the Germans withdraw to these deeply embedded defensive positions northeast of the old Somme battlefield, when they do that in March 1917 in Operation Albrecht, they destroyed the zone they abandoned. It was a scorched earth policy, poisoned wells, demolished villages, and the population was deported. This, too, shocked French and Allied opinion, and became the subject, or one of the subjects, of the renewed cultural mobilization. Here we see this society, Souvenez-vous, which in fact has been set up to remember the events of 1914, set up by Léo Mirmont, the prefect of the Meurthe-et-Moselle, but here it is taking on the new themes of 1917, the deportation of hapless French civilians to the rear as their homes are destroyed for German defensive military needs. It remains hard to gauge the impact of cultural remobilization on the French home front. But the fact that it took place at all indicates what it mobilized against, namely the awfulness of the war and the dilution of enmity. The campaign reflected this. It used more sober terms than in 1914, and it explicitly addressed both the horror of the conflict and the desire for peace. Here we have a war loan poster for 1917, but which explicitly addresses the horrors of war and absence, the separation of the family. The absent father at the front, represented simply by his portrait over the bed, the wife left alone with the girl. Pour que vos enfants ne connaissent plus les horreurs de la guerre, you have to keep on fighting to the end. And it won't have escaped your notice that the dress that the little doll in the bed is wearing is Alsatian costume. But equally, from the same year, this very graphic war loan poster, which shows, again, in this publicity campaign, souscrivez pour être la paix par la victoire. Peace is actually addressed, but the idea is to hasten peace, but by victory, rather than by negotiation. And we have, of course, the angel of victory restraining the figure of peace, who virgin-like carries a child in her arms. The French remobilized opinion for the war in 1918, but this meant recognizing in some way what the war itself had become. I come now to the second totalizing logic of the war that I'd like to talk about this afternoon, which is battle. Now, for the French, this battle meant above all the Western Front. In late May 1917, soldiers at rest behind the lines, who had recently taken part in the failed offensive of General Nivelle, showed signs of discontent and refused to return to the trenches. For 2 months, peaking in late June, the protests spread to units that had not been involved in the offensive. Soldiers would drink and sing, and then they would refuse to obey orders and issue their own demands. The commonest of these demands concerned home leave, rest, and help for their families left without them at home. But the unifying gesture was the refusal to go back into the trenches to fight the kind of war represented by General Nivelle's campaign. The protesters' symbols and language were those of socialism and the strike. They waved the red flag. They often sang the Internationale. They invoked the Russian Revolution with its Soviets, which had broken out shortly before. Some 50 to 60,000 men were actively involved in a movement that touched 80 to 100 divisions, or 75% of those on the Western Front. But over 2 million Frenchmen were ranged against the Germans, so that many in even the most affected units did not protest. The mutinies were a headache for the new commander, Philippe Pétain, who'd been brought in to replace Nivelle. But what did they signify? This, of course, has been one of the most studied aspects of the First World War in France. The mutinies have been seen as a military strike by Guy Petroncini, as a renegotiation by citizen soldiers of the terms on which they were prepared to fight, essentially the interpretation of Leonard Smith, and as a social revolt by the groups that made up the bulk of the infantry, mainly peasants and the lower middle classes, an interpretation put forward by André Loez. And there is truth in all of these views, but I want to suggest a different interpretation that goes to the heart of battle itself and its own totalizing logic. It begins, this interpretation, with a paradox. The mutinies occurred in the year when the French army had the lowest casualties of the entire war. The highest toll came in the opening 5 months in 1914, during the War of Movement, and this was followed by 1915. Before Verdun and the Somme, the battles that symbolized the violence of the war had even begun in 1916. 665,000 French soldiers had died, nearly half the total. The shock to French society was huge. French society in 1915 was a society in mass mourning already at the beginning of the war. Despite many warning signs, most contemporaries before 1914 failed to anticipate the true nature of a future war in which industrialized firepower, machine guns, high explosive shells, and large concentrations of field and heavy artillery would give the defensive a decisive advantage over the attacking infantry. Military thinking was based on the reverse idea that, properly motivated and led, vast armies of civilian soldiers, the French mobilized two-thirds of the adult male population during the war, would triumph in a war of maneuver. Instead, the opposed armies mutually besieged each other until the German spring offensive in 1918. And what I mean by that is that sometimes it's said, I mean, obviously that siege warfare that trench warfare was a kind of siege warfare. It was, but it was a radically new form of siege warfare. In traditional siege warfare, one army besieges a strong position which defends itself. But in this case, each side was besieging the other, defending itself and attacking the other side mutually. Each side was both Trojan and Greek. And it happened not just on the Western Front, but in Italy and in Macedonia and in the East. In effect, Europe was a war of mutual siege around its peripheries. Trench warfare made perfect sense. It was a system of reciprocal defense that saved lives, those lives that had been so prodigiously lost in the open warfare, the mobile warfare of the autumn of 1914. But the trouble was that it couldn't be broken. Frontal assault failed repeatedly. Strategic options were tried on other fronts, but with a few exceptions, they replicated the dominance of the defensive. Doing nothing was not an option. So each side sought to gain the edge on the other with more powerful means of destruction that would break the defensive and give victory, whether by gas, tanks, aviation, heavy artillery. But each time, it transpired that the balance had not tilted far enough. Hence the pattern of continually renewed offensives designed to achieve breakthrough, or at Verdun, to break French morale, but which reverted to a logic of attrition, that the enemy had supposedly lost more men and material than one had oneself, and so would be weaker next time. This was the totalizing logic of the military conflict, and it produced the overwhelming violence of the war. In November 1918, new offensive techniques and coalition warfare gave the Allies the edge. But even then, their victory was due, it seems to me, just as much to the disproportionate effects of attrition on the Central Powers, which were hollowed out from within. And anyway, the victory was still not total. Yet the French High Command, imbued with the logic of total enmity against Germany, and the imperative of expelling the invader, believed in the offensive against all the evidence. Here, and it was a much wider belief in society, we have from the Second War Loan, 1916, the very famous Abel Fèvre image of this, on les aura, we will get them, we will beat them. Offensive French poilu leading the successful attack. And the British allies of the French similarly believed in the offensive. In their way, so too did the Germans. The French soldiers shared the mindset of their own high command, but of course from a very different perspective. Their experience from late 1914 to Nivelles' offensive in April 1917 was driven by the logic of the renewed offensive, designed and announced each time as the one that would bring victory. The exception was Verdun, which was a German battle, when 70% of French soldiers were rotated through a devastating experience in which they nonetheless had the moral advantage of defending home ground. Not to lose was to win. Like the Marne in 1914, and unlike the French offensives, Verdun enjoyed instant epic status, but it could not win the war. How should we describe this outlook by the High Command, which framed the soldiers' own experience of combat? A belief? A myth? A paradigm? The answer, it seems to me, matters, since much of the military history of the war assumes that there were solutions which the generals just didn't find. Whereas I want to suggest that for much of the war, there was no solution, but that this was hard for those in power to admit. The soldiers and junior officers, however, learned reality the hard way, especially in the great offensives. Time and again, they were told that these would break through the German lines, restore the war of movement, and win the conflict. Nivelle, in 1917, promised exactly what Joffre had in 1915. Time and again, breakthrough turned into a logic of usure, of attrition. The enemy lost more than we did, which was an unprovable assertion. There was a social aspect to the May July mutinies. These were protests not by workers who were in the arms factories, but by peasants and lower middle class men who often had little tradition of revolt. There was a political aspect too, as the men, invoking their status as citizen soldiers, tried to gain control over the kind of war that they would fight, without abandoning fighting as such. There were no protests, for example, in the front lines. But the overriding logic was cultural. This was the moment when the horizon of expectations, that's to say, the soldiers' vision of their own future, caught up, the soldiers' vision of their own future and the image of warfare that determined it, which derived from the 19th century, this was when that broke down. The mutinies expressed the cognitive shift in the soldiers' view of the war they were fighting. It was the moment when language caught up with reality. Pétain responded by being more cautious with offensives, using new tactics and technology, and improving conditions for the men. The idea now was less breakthrough than holding on, illustrated by this war loan poster from the final year of the war. And there we have Pétain with his patient staff officers with him, and the French army trudging slowly forward. Note the rifles are sloped over their shoulders. They're not held in the advanced bayonet fixed position of the attack. And in the description, it is pour le dernier quart d'heure, for the last quarter of an hour, after Clemenceau's famous declaration that the side which would win would be the one that believed it could win for a quarter of an hour longer than its opponent. The sense that the French were fighting a coalition war, which had been there from the start, now became acute in the final 18 months of the conflict, although we still have much more to find out about their contact with and their perceptions of the 3 million British Empire and American troops who were fighting on their soil by 1918 in this reconfigured, now Western alliance or coalition once Russia had exited the war. Supplying armies is a condition of their effectiveness in the field. However, supplying them in the First World War required an industrial as well as a military mobilization. No one had predicted this. Since workers and soldiers both had to be fed, farming was also crucial once the conflict outlasted the harvests of 1914. Capital was vital too, whether to fund production or buy supplies abroad. In these ways, the logic of attrition, apparent from late 1914, was quickly translated into the economy. It meant producing more than the enemy so as to bring greater industrialized firepower to bear on him than he could manage in return. It also meant not only wearing down his fighting power, but interdicting his own capacity to supply the war. This, in other words, was logistics, but on a grand scale, the scale of national economies. The social corollary of this economic effort was the creation of what in Britain became known as the Home Front. In other words, the civilian reorganization needed in order to achieve material superiority and to feed it back onto the battlefield to secure victory. This third totalizing logic shaped the French war experience in several ways. One was the belief as early as the winter of 1914-15 in the need to deprive Germany of food and supplies. While naval blockade was a traditional form of warfare, especially for the British, it was arguably more serious in a world of greater economic interdependence than it had been a century earlier, and especially when the material construction of war supplies required raw materials and other goods brought from different countries. In the press and elsewhere, the French quickly expressed the desire to starve the German population into submission, and France went on to play a minor but serious role in the blockade. So right from the start, from early 1915, the desire that, yes, we cut off all food supplies and we look for the evidence that that German civilians, women and children, are starving, this becomes part of the scenario of warfare for French civilians. The French went on to play a minor but serious role in the Allied blockade. The German riposte was unrestricted U-boat warfare, briefly in 1915 and for real in 1917, which aimed in turn to starve the Allies of food and supplies. By the logic of enmity, each side accused the other of war crimes, starving civilians or torpedoing them. But the French were able to use British naval superiority to supply their own war effort from overseas, including the Empire. And this in turn provoked, or at least justified in their own eyes, the ever harsher exploitation by Germany of occupied France. Now, I could talk further on the impact of this aspect of the totalizing logic of economic warfare, which bore in different ways on the experiences of occupied France and the French colonies. Yesterday, in a fascinating session, we talked about French colonial history and how it intersects with the war and how one uses that to try and write a transnational history of the First World War. And I would suggest that in this intimate relationship between the Allies' ability through the naval blockade and maritime control to bring the supplies of the Empire and the rest of the world to France while interdicting it to Germany, and Germany's therefore increasingly intensive exploitation of German-occupied Europe, which was a very, very considerable area during the First World War, that reciprocal relationship is precisely one of the international dynamics that we can use to understand this increasing violence and the breaking of norms and even laws of war by both sides during the conflict. And I'll happily return to this matter, if people wish, in discussion. But here I want to focus on the strain that industrial and economic mobilization imposed on the home front, because it challenged the moral and the ideological foundations on which the military effort was organized. Every belligerent faced this problem, and how it was solved was vital to the experience and the outcome of the conflict. Like other belligerents, the French mobilized all adult men from 20 to 50. Going back to the French Revolution, citizens were also soldiers, and war generated its own republican equality, the impôt du sang, the blood tax, paid by all male citizens. The idea of equality thus underpinned a kind of binary model of mobilization, with civilians, the interior, or the home front, supporting soldiers, the fighting front, who were making the supreme sacrifice. It's exactly that binary relationship that Guy Arnoux was suggesting with his woodprints in 1918. But industrial mobilization was organized on a different principle, the division of labor and the specialization of function. It was more Durkheim than Danton, and it meant that skilled workers were pulled out of battle and sent to the war factories in the interior, so escaping the risk of death. Though still subject to military discipline, they were paid normal wages, could dress and live as they wished, and resumed their civilian identity. There were over 400,000 of them. Labor shortages also resulted in women, immigrants, and Frenchmen below and above military service age, making up a munitions workforce that by 1918 numbered 1.7 million people, almost the same as the 2 million soldiers on the front. War itself eroded the neat binary distinction between soldier and civilian. Although access to global and colonial supplies meant that living standards never declined in France or Britain to the same extent as in the Central Powers or Russia, a class society was nonetheless reconstituted in the midst of war. This intersected with other tensions created by gender and race. Women occupied a key place in the war economy, not because they worked in factories, many had worked in factories before the war, but because they now worked in men's work and took over from men. That was the difference. And France, for the first time, recruited on a very large scale colonial and Chinese workers to work in the metropole on farms and in factories and in hospitals. Again, state surveillance tells us a great deal about this totalizing logic, that of supply and the creation of the home front and its internal tensions by 1917. The first major strike wave of the war occurred in June in Paris and spread to other industrial regions. Women workers, first in clothing, then in munitions, played a vital role. Their prime motive was wage increases against inflation. But weary of separation, they called for the return of their husbands and their replacement at the front by the bosses. Les patrons au front was one of the cries as they paraded through the streets. Meanwhile, mutinying soldiers protested at the quite false rumor, as it turned out, that Indo-Chinese cavalry had been used against their striking wives. Race riots, quite serious race riots, erupted across France in 1917 against North African and Chinese workers, with the North Africans in particular accused of freeing up French workers for the army while stealing their wives and daughters. But the workers themselves were also subject to attack. For the skilled workers who had been recalled from the front were seen as embusqués, or shirkers, and of course there was a word for that in the language of every country fighting the war, were seen as shirkers by those who had no protection from the risk of death in the trenches, such as rural and lower middle class men and their families back home, especially their wives. The workers in turn accused the peasants and others of driving up prices, although shortages were the essential cause. The generals who commanded the internal military regions of France reported in March 1918 as follows. Antagonism grows between workers in the towns and workers in the countryside. The former reproach the second for selling their crops at exaggerated prices. The peasants, the cultivateurs on the contrary, who have to carry out their work with reduced manpower, are envious of the workers in the towns, who are of military service age and earn high wages in the war factories. Women in the countryside, in particular, show a good deal of overexcitement concerning this subject, so gender interleafing class. In short, the war generated a specific social morality, whose key measure was the sacrifice of the frontline soldier. But this was undermined by the need for an economic mobilization that required unequal sacrifice. It set peasants against workers, consumers against producers and retailers, and those with war contracts, the profiteers, against everyone. The police chief at Saint-Étienne, a major munitions center, complained in mid-1917, and I quote, about those who have made a profit from the war and flaunt an insolent sense of luxury. They should be more reserved, for their attitude is commented on very unfavorably and serves the interests of those who preach the class struggle, end of quote. And you can imagine his irritation at these people who've made large amounts of money walking around in their fur coats or driving around in their newly acquired cars. Such social tensions eroded the morality of sacrifice at home as well as on the fighting front, as shown by soldiers who advised their wives not to subscribe to war loans or to farm more land, in order to shorten a war to which they felt they'd already given quite enough. Here, a postcard from the archive of the Loire, and here you'll note that the postcard is a war loans postcard using the selfsame image of Abel Fèvre of the triumphant offensive, but the soldier who's addressed it to the prefect of the Loire, and it's interesting that he felt entitled to use his own name. He signs it as he writes in pencil to the prefect, and he says, "Dear Monsieur le Préfet, by the grace of His Excellency Poincaré and His Majesty Guillaume, we've been acquainted for more than 2 years now in the trenches with the beauties of the abattoir. We hope to get to know them even better thanks to the generous subscription to the second national war loan that we're expecting from you. The people in the rear are holding on, and that's a great consolation to us, the infantry in the French first lines, who are fighting for the sacred cause of justice and international law. Let me finish with a piece of advice. Open up your safes, go down into your cellars for fear of the Zeppelins," which of course were threatening Paris at that point, "with frozen feet, Jean Aymar." And in another postcard, the same man writes, interestingly, about his experience at the front, no soldier can advise subscribing to the loan because, one, victory is not possible for any of the belligerents, even if all of the rest of the French were to be killed. And two, the poilus are nearly all fathers of families and know that even the cleverest of their wives cannot raise their little ones honestly, even with the military separation allowances that the rich give them. And a flick there at the notion that these weren't an entitlement, the military allowances, but they were given to those in need. They were an act of charity, which struck a false note with soldiers who felt that as citizens they were fighting at the front. The solution turned on defeating U-boat warfare and maintaining international supplies. It meant defending the workers' purchasing power and introducing rationing so as to restore some fairness to distributions. As the generals remarked in May 1918, in order to maintain the morale of the population, there must never be any bread shortages. It also meant acknowledging peasant sacrifice by sending rural soldiers home for the most vital farm work, thus recognizing that the division of labor applied to agriculture as well as industry. All this happened in late 1917, 1918. These solutions were found, but it was a race to ward off inevitably deteriorating conditions, which simply became more acute more quickly in both Russia and the Central Powers. David Stevenson, in his excellent book, With Our Backs to the Wall, on 1918, uses the notion of the race to the bottom. And the point is that the British and the French were simply racing to the bottom somewhat more slowly than the Germans and the Austrians, and the Russians had certainly got there first. By 1917, the French faced war weariness on a significant scale, forcing them to renew the cultural mobilization for total victory against the German enemy. Nonetheless, this could only work by recognizing how problematic the war itself, its nature, its duration, its horror had become. At the heart of 1917 stood the mutinies. If the First World War marked the transition from the man-based warfare of the 19th century to the machine-based warfare of the 20th century, it took 3 years for a parallel revolution in the understanding of war to take place. The mutinies marked that moment for the soldiers. And they were one of the factors that forced both the government and the high command to fight the war differently in 1918. The French had also found, like others, that the industrial effort needed for victory meant an economic division of labor that resulted in multiple social tensions, which had to be actively managed. Enmity, battle, and supply all shaped the wartime experiences of the French, as of other belligerent peoples, and their escalating logic posed major problems that came to a head in 1917. The effort to solve them inevitably raised the question of the political legitimacy of the wartime state. Here I return to the first term of my title, Total War. In July 1917, Georges Clemenceau, in his bid to become prime minister, demanded the all-out commitment of the nation's resources to overcoming the enemy. 4 months later, in his inaugural speech as prime minister, he demanded the solidarity of the home front with the fighting front in une guerre intégrale, or an absolute war. A year later, the far-right politician Léon Daudet wrote a book called La Guerre Totale. Referring admiringly to Clemenceau, Daudet defined total war as the inclusion of every aspect of national life in the war. Quote, "It is not only the armies that fight, it is also traditions, institutions, customs, codes, mines, and above all, banks." Both total war and absolute war, though far from being household terms, were used in France over the last year of the conflict. The French thus coined the term total war. Of course, they hardly invented the reality behind it, though it is interesting to note that Ludendorff's better-known use in his memoirs and in his 1935 book, Der totale Krieg, explicitly acknowledged the advantage that the French had enjoyed during the Great War owing to the mobilizing myth of the French Revolution, something that he counted on National Socialism to supply in a future war of revenge. What Clemenceau meant by absolute war and Daudet by total war was a political endeavor that placed the totality of society's resources behind the effort to defeat a total enemy. It was an aspiration. As we've said, nothing is ever total. Yet it drew on the symbolism of 1793 when, as France was invaded, the convention had declared the levée en masse, and as is well known and much better known to many people here present than to myself, this potentially conscripted all young single men and enjoined married men to forge arms and transport provisions, creating a war economy, while women made uniforms and manned the hospitals, and old men preached, quote, the unity of the Republic and hatred of kings, end of quote. It was a myth, but it was an effective one. And I would submit that it anticipated the total war to which states aspired in the 20th century and remained a touchstone of French republicanism. The figure of Rude's sculpture of the Le Départ des Volontaires on the Arc de Triomphe in Paris, here used in a cheap popular series, La Patrie, during the First World War, was omnipresent during the First World War. That figure, that incarnation of the levée en masse, was a symbol that all French people recognized. In the last year of the conflict, Clemenceau embodied this myth, and thus the political will to oversee the changes required by the three wartime dynamics that I've described. He was unquestionably a Republican politician, and in his own way, despite the socialists' hostility, he was a man of the left. He invented, it seems to me, a new figure, as Lloyd George and Woodrow Wilson also did in 1917-1918. This was the democratic war leader, a man of the word. Clemenceau was both orator and journalist, who incarnated popular authority and could galvanize the nation without destroying the democracy, the essentials of the democracy for which the war was allegedly being fought. Churchill and Roosevelt perfected this figure 25 years later. In the short term, this worked. France could claim victory. But 1917 left its mark in other ways. For just as total war was an impossibility, there were too many countercurrents, so the armistice in November 1918 was not quite the total victory hoped for. The victory parade took place down the Champs-Élysées, not the Unter den Linden. The feeling that had emerged among soldiers and civilians by 1917, after 3 years of effort, that war itself was the real problem, didn't go away. It found expression in the belief that securing the world for permanent peace was no less important than defeating Germany. Certainly, this view was strongest on the left, among those who had withheld their support from Clemenceau in 1917, but it was by no means confined to them. In other words, the horror of a war that afflicted all who fought it made the notion of enmity relative. 1917 was not the moment when the war was first referred to as carnage, butchery, and industrialized slaughter. With growing force, that tendency from the autumn of 19 was there, especially at the front, and the death figures that I showed should explain why. But 1917 was the moment when this language broke loose from the countervailing discourse of necessary sacrifice, of acceptance. No less a person than Pétain recognized the phenomenon in describing the disillusionment felt by the soldiers shortly after the mutinies, and I quote, "Incessant minor actions during which they encounter machine guns buried and protected by barbed wire, and which only result in fleeting success that costs them dear, and after which the bodies abandoned between the lines remind the survivors of the inanity of the sacrifices agreed to." End of quote. If the two ideas of suffering and sacrifice, the two sensibilities, were reunited sufficiently to see the war through to its end, it was no longer the same once peace arrived. In the 1920s, a significant and growing number of French people came to feel that if the victory was the culmination of enmity against Germany, peace was and should be something different. The real enemy, for many, became war itself. In this sense, 1917 was a turning point. Janus faced, the year generated a remobilized patriotism leading to victory, while also crystallizing a moral repudiation of the war, even among many who conceded that it must be won, which influenced a longer-term mobilization in favor of peace in the later 1920s and the 1930s, a process which in other writing I've described as cultural demobilization. Here we have an example from a trade union poster, International, 1924, guerre à la guerre, but you'll notice that the image is exactly the same, or is very closely related to the one that we saw during the war, of the soldier protecting his wife and children, but here he's protecting them not against the national enemy, but against war itself. The campaign of the mid-1920s of le désarmement moral, moral disarmament, against war toys for children, and so on. 1917, in other words, was the moment when imagined war caught up with real war. It left a deeply ambiguous legacy, ultimately expressed in the 30,000 war memorials raised across the land, the plan for one in the Tarn, and in a powerful movement of anciens combattants magisterially studied by Antoine Pro, whose leitmotif by the later 1920s was a stance of patriotic pacifism. France could and did take pride in having invented the means and the modernity to win a totalizing war. For one way to understand the Allied victory is to see it as the capacity of parliamentary states successfully to wage a military and industrial conflict. Few of the Third Republic's detractors, at home or abroad, would have predicted this. Yet France had won at such a cost in human lives and suffering that victory could only really be secure if war on this scale never had to be fought again. The ambiguity of this legacy held the seeds of a very different experience of war a quarter of a century later. Thank you very much.
Stimulating lecture, full of interesting ideas, and I'm sure there's going to be a lot of discussion. So we have two microphones on either side of the lecture theater. We're linked by video to the next room as well. And if anyone sort of within arm's length of me needs the microphone, I can pass this one over to you. I'm sure there will be lots of things to ask Professor Horne about. Could you identify yourself, just so we all know who you are, before you ask your question?
Hi, I'm Michael Christofferson at Adelphi University. I noticed in your discussion of three different areas, enmity, battle, and supply, that in a sense there is a social dimension to battle. You talked specifically about the social identity of the mutineers. There's a social dimension to supply, obviously, the conflicts that you outlined. But there doesn't seem to be any social dimension to enmity. And you know, perhaps that reflects the historiography on this question, where the proponents of the couture de guerre thesis, in a sense, assume there's sort of universal consent. And the question of precisely who's producing these images, and these images generally are being produced by cultural elites, and who's consuming them, and what meanings they're taking out of the consumption aren't perhaps as dressed as fully as they might be. And so I'd like to ask you, would it be possible to write a social history of that enmity, of the different social differentiation within it, and what would be its sources, and what might be its conclusions? Perhaps that history already exists, although I don't know of it. And is it something that's possible to pursue? Is it worth pursuing? And what would you think of it?
Thank you very much. It's a great question, and I accept, because I wanted to try and convey the both the power and the content of the view of enmity that I was concentrating on cultural production. But I do think in two senses that I think you're right that it's a social history which probably hasn't been written yet, but I believe it to be entirely possible to do so. And I in the work which I'm doing at the moment, I address it in two ways. One is just to interrogate that notion of who is producing it and the elites. And you're quite right that there are elite organizations, although, as I say, for the first part of the war, it's very striking how the state is much more concerned with propaganda abroad than what we might call propaganda at home. And that already gives one a sense that the production is really, some historians have taken to using the term horizontal production and circulation of this kind of cultural material. It really is quite diffuse and widespread. Those postcards I showed at the beginning, which come from the collection at the Musée d'Histoire Contemporaine in Paris, I mean, they're part of a collection of 70,000 postcards, and they were produced by small corner shops. They weren't in response to a kind of felt public demand. They were a commercial enterprise, and I think the same is true when one looks at the press. The range of the press in France, particularly when one goes down looking at the local press and the semaine religieuse, the parochial press, and so on and so forth, one gets the sense that if this is an elite production, those elites are pretty wide and they go down very deep in French society. The same thing I think is true when one looks at the trade union movement or at the socialists, often at the local level. This discourse is there. And I would go a stage further and say that I think that one of the enormous strengths in part of the work that I'm doing at the moment, I look at the whole business of charitable mobilization. And one of the huge strengths of France was, despite what's sometimes seen as the slightly shaky political system because of the often rapidly changing governments, was a solidity of the administrative system through which the prefects, with their tentacles in the departments, but their sense of connection with the local elected mayors and their ability to plug in to civic society organizations is really quite remarkable. And I would have to say that I believe in 1917, 1918, whereas we see a collapse, a sheer collapse of that in Tsarist Russia, we see it deeply shaken in Italy with a kind of slight recovery after Caporetto, and we see a disarray increasingly in Austria and Germany. We don't see that in the French case, and I don't think we do in the British case. And in work which I've published, in fact, on the cultural demobilization, seeing how far down that union of great associations goes, or the role which the primary school teachers, whose job, we must always recall, includes adult education as well. So they're actually traipsing around the district and knocking on doors and asking people to come to the talk on Sunday afternoon. These are extraordinarily both diffuse and powerful mechanisms of cultural mobilization. But the heart of the question is that, fortunately in the French case, because it's such a nosy state and so interested in monitoring morale, we do have all kinds of reports, even from 1915, by the prefects, by the local commissaire de police, which allow one to explore where it's not taking, where there's the resistance. The kind of postcard which I showed from the archives of the Loire. And I would have to say that at that level, it seems to me that often there is a connection with the overwhelming discourse. But as I was suggesting, there's an alternative language of peace, and it's parallel, not necessarily directly confrontational, which one can see emerging towards 1917. And so I believe that, yes, indeed, I'm not suggesting, I just had one caveat in which I did say that we must not assume that this cultural self-mobilization for the war works for all of the population. And I think there are ways of trying to discover who's resistant to it. If I can just conclude this point with one small example. We find in Rennes, in the Ille-et-Vilaine, as in so many towns in France, an arsenal, munitions work, develops 3,000 employees by 1917. In 1915 and 1916, the workers subscribe voluntarily on quite a significant scale to the war loans drive. In 1917, not only do they not, but they sell off some of their 1916 bonds in order to fund the strike campaign which they're running. So there are indeed all sorts of materials which allow one to establish this.
I think Professor Pro has a question.
Oui, je suis tout à fait d'accord avec toi et je développe des thèmes tout à fait similaires. À certains moments, tu as dit des choses que je dirais à ma façon tout à l'heure. Il y a deux points sur lesquels je discuterai. Il y en a un sur les mutineries, mais il est trop technique pour que je l'aborde ici. L'autre, c'est la construction de l'ennemi. Ce qui m'interroge, c'est que le soldat allemand n'est pas un ennemi au même sens que pour les citoyens, que pour les civils. Le soldat allemand qui est en face, c'est un autre. C'est quelqu'un qui souffre les mêmes maux, qui est soumis aux mêmes risques, qui éprouve les mêmes peurs. Et ceci très tôt. Les fraternisations de Noël 1914 ne sont pas le seul exemple de cette proximité entre les soldats. Donc je me demande si la construction de l'ennemi n'est pas à l'usage de l'intérieur. Et au niveau du front, on n'a pas besoin de construire l'ennemi. Il est défini par la position qu'il occupe. L'ennemi, c'est celui qui est en face, c'est celui sur lequel il faut tirer et celui qui vous tire dessus. Donc il n'y a pas besoin de faire cette construction culturelle pour les soldats. La réalité est plus forte que le discours.
Thank you very much. And I look forward to the other technical point on the mutinies later. But this sense then in which while the construction of enmity may work at the home front, it really is very different at the fighting front, because the soldiers, the Germans are simply those opposite, and since one has to fight them every so often, that creates its own sort of enmity, but it doesn't have to be ideologically or culturally framed. And I think there's a great deal to that, and your question goes to the heart of some of the tensions, naturally, between the fighting front and the home front. But in my thinking on this, and I've, as part of the work I'm doing at the moment, I've taken 10 regiments and I've tried to follow them through the war and using all the sources I can, the postal control and so on and so forth. And I think I've come to this conclusion that it's partly the phenomenon that you describe is partly defined by the interpretation that I was giving of siege warfare, this mutual siege warfare. And I suspect that if one goes back in history, I mean, I'd be interested to have comparative views on this, that one of the things about siege warfare in which there are long periods of immobility is that it's impossible to maintain the same degree of combatant tension. The Iliad, which is our great text on siege warfare, is full of such moments. And I believe, indeed, that this helps explain the live-and-let-live system, the mutual survival on both sides. And yet, it's punctuated by the imperative of the offensive. And you might say, but even then, what matters is simply that your own military effort is forcing you to attack the enemy. But I sense that there are moments, notably in the fighting in the offensives, and in other changes in the other strategic changes in the war, when that sense of personal enmity can recur. So that in the adrenaline of the attack, in whatever it takes that you need to psych yourself up for that offensive warfare, often the soldiers then in their letters home express feelings of enmity closer to those that I was describing. And of course there are the moments then, it's very clear in the advance from the Marne in 1914 when they discover the traces of the so-called German atrocities and simply the level of devastation, that creates a sense of anger on the part of the soldiers. We find the same thing when they cross the terrain, the destroyed terrain, to the Siegfried line in 1917. And part of the final 100 years, the final 100 days of the war, it seemed 100 years to those who were fighting their way through it, was discovering again the same scorched earth policy on the part of the Germans as they withdrew, and that reanimated a sense of hostility to the enemy. But it's a fluctuating thing, and I think you're absolutely right that fighting the enemy doesn't necessarily require that formulation of enmity in the same way that the home front needs it.
Professor Clark.
Well, first of all, thank you very much, John, for a wonderfully evocative and textured account, which I thought managed to be evocative without ever ceasing to be analytical. And I wanted to... My question really is about where one can fit violence into this, because, the experiences of battle and enmity are linked, obviously, with the experience of violence. And I was wondering, and you are also the author, the co-editor of a pioneering study on this transition to the post-war world and to a world in which ultra-violence becomes part of politics in a way that it wasn't before the First World War. And yet, that doesn't seem to be a transition that necessarily applies very neatly to France. It's something that works very well for Germany, for Hungary, and for other states. Why is that right? And if so, why is that? I was wondering, as you, when you talked before about the robustness of the French administration, I wondered if you were already answering my question. But I was just wondering if you had any thoughts on that.
Yeah, thank you. No, it's a great question, and obviously one which in doing that work on paramilitary violence after the war, with Robert Gerwardt, we thought a great deal about. I mean, as people may well know, in this debate about brutalization, there was the rather precise, I think, thesis which was put forward by George Mosser in his book Fallen Soldiers, in which he argued that the experience of German soldiers during the First World War in the context of defeat and dislocation in post-war Germany created a political culture of violence and a practice of political violence, which he called brutalization. So it was related to the war, but it was refracted by what happened to Germany at the end of the war. And that's what I interpret Mosser to have been saying. And I think the notion was then taken up as a rather portmanteau explanation as to what happened to all soldiers and how they came back and how they found readjustment difficult and why the post-war world was more violent than the pre-war world. And I think there are certain elements of that transition on which the jury is still out. For example, I know that work has been done, and there's more work being done at the moment on domestic violence and the question of whether soldiers from whatever country it was when they returned home simply expressed some of their difficulties of fitting back into civvy life by violence shown towards their women, towards their womenfolk, towards their families, or indeed in ordinary crime. But Antoine Preux, I think, has written persuasively in relation to France, arguing that the brutalization thesis really doesn't apply to France. And I have to say that I completely agree with that. In some respects, the conclusion is the conclusion of that, if that is correct, is even more sobering. That's to say that men can engage in warfare for 4.5 years, and they can go through the sorts of experiences that I was indicating, and they can kill their fellow human being. And if it is sanctified by the entity in whose name they're doing it, and they return home with their sacrifice validated, then they can sleep in their beds at night. They may experience post-traumatic stress disorder, but that is different, I think, from engaging in violent, especially politically violent behavior because of what they went through in the war. So my conclusion is that in the French case, I'm not convinced, firstly, that politics in the 1920s is more violent, either rhetorically or physically, than it was before 1914. We could argue the point if we then move forward and look at the 1930s, but we have then the effects of the Depression to talk about. And secondly, it seems to me that the actual brutalization of politics as a result of the war is fundamentally linked, firstly, to defeat, and secondly, to breakdown in all kinds of ways. So breakdown of the political structures, which, as you say, Chris, remains relatively stable in France, but breakdown in ideological and other terms. And I would just conclude the point by saying that in the book that we did on and our collective research project on paramilitary violence after the war, which was principally focused on Central Europe, Eastern Europe, and the case of Ireland, I deliberately took the French case as a counterexample. And what I argued in that was a kind of paradoxical conclusion, which is that down to 1923, when one does find paramilitary violence elsewhere with the sortie de guerre, that in the French case there is civic unrest in France as in Britain, but the use of the Union Civique, of the strike breakers and so on, is actually a remobilization of civic society as during the war, and the use of the Union Civique is very carefully demarcated from paramilitary use. These are people who are not prepared to be used as surrogate agents of the state. It's out of a civic notion of duty that they're keeping the country running against the new enemy, which they see as Bolshevism, having replaced the Boche. And paradoxically, it's only after 1924, when the Cartel de Gauche has come to power, and those who see France as having been victorious in 1918, but always with this sense of instability, one can never be absolutely sure one's won, the fear now is that domestic politicians are going to throw it away. And that's the moment when the FESO is formed, Georges Valois' FESO. That's the moment when the Jeunesse Patriote is formed explicitly on a paramilitary basis, because it's the moment when a kind of defeat looms 5 years after the war. It doesn't last very long. It's gone by 1926, but it's the counter-demonstration.
I think I will use my droit de présidence to ask a question.
Please.
I was intrigued by some of the things you said about the reach of the French state during the war, and I think that's very true. The best example I've ever come across was a meeting of three women of the Comité de la Rue Fonderie, at which one of them was an indicatrice who wrote a report for the police that was on the commissaire de police's desk the following morning. So that's fairly good surveillance. And the French have also done a very good job of keeping an eye on things like the Société d'études critiques sur les origines de la guerre. And so all of this makes me wonder whether the French ability to exercise surveillance over their own citizens cannot perhaps be applied to the level of constraint that they were able to apply to their soldiers. Now, I know that this is becoming an old debate, but for those of you who don't know about this debate, there was about 8 or 10 years ago a rather large debate in France between the so-called École de Péron and the École de Crane, and it was largely over the issue of consent versus constraint. And I'm wondering if you could say something about that debate and about how you see that issue of constraint versus consent in French history with regard to the First World War. Sure.
Thank you. Yeah, well, I mean, clearly there is constraint. I mean, one of the things that states do is constrain. And it always seemed to me, you know, that there was a kind of slightly sterile polarization in the positions which were sometimes attributed to those participating in the debate. So the powers of constraint and enforcement of the French state during the war were considerable, but not illimited. And I think they were limited in a number of particular ways. One is that, and this was something we were discussing earlier today, that the state of siege law in France, amended in 1878 by the emerging republic, stipulated that Parliament had to remain in a session to control and keep under surveillance the operation of the state of siege, of the state of exception. So that if you look at Giorgio Agamben's very interesting work about states of exception, he identifies the origin of the states of exception, in fact, in the states of siege during the First World War, but they covered many different kinds of state of siege legislation. And as I say, in the French case, Parliament remained in operation, and the parliamentary deputies and the parliamentary commissions interfered, monitored, sometimes even obstructed the working of the war effort, but at crucial moments became moderators in the force of the state. And indeed, I mean, I didn't want to go into that whole political dimension of it, but from 1916, the role which soldier deputies play in forcing the government, forcing the hand of the government in trying to re-establish some control over this situation in which the generals don't have any real control over what's happening on the ground is quite powerful. So that would be my first answer to it. The second is that somebody has said, I forget who, that you know, a state is only in trouble when its police and its agents start revolting. In the case of the French state during the war, what I said about the prefects, I think, is true, but also the parallel powers of the generals who control the military regions in the interior. It's a kind of parallel authority with that of the civilian prefects. In reality, the civilian prefects predominate, but you have these two parallel structures. But so the agents don't revolt, but the very thing you point to, that flow of information, gives all sorts of possibilities of negotiation. And one of the things which, in very different ways, the French and the British states do in 1917, 1918, is they do negotiate. Part of the construction of that class society on the home front is nonetheless the recognition of a form of corporatism in which the different entities are allowed to represent themselves, and negotiations, pourparlers, constantly take place. Albert Thomas is away in Russia on a mission trying to persuade the Russian government to stay in the war when the women strikes or the munitionnet strikes break out in 1917. Malvy, the Minister of the Interior, intervenes and he negotiates. He gets the trade unions around the table. He has his sheaf of police reports about what they're saying and thinking and uses that as the basis to negotiate an acceptable outcome. So my second answer would be that I think, and this is one of the interpretations one can apply to the mutinies, that there is a form of social negotiation with which the French state engages, which is not simple constraint. It's trying to renegotiate some form of consent, and it's often strained almost to breaking point, but it does actually happen. And in societies like Russia or Italy, it's a much more brutal interface in which that negotiating buffer, as it were, is much less evident.
Can you move to... I have a large voice.
All right, because my arm is not that long.
Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Okay. Given the nature of what you've described and analyzed so beautifully and sadly, can you imagine a different kind of peace coming out of this kind?
I have two answers to the question. Thanks. It's a really interesting question. First answer is the cop out. I don't do counterfactual history because I always feel that once one's advanced two steps down that road, the variables become so large that one's simply engaging in fiction. Although it can be fun to do. But let me answer the question this way. I think there are two French exits from the war. And I think it's not just true of France. I think it's true of other countries too. I mean, I come from a country where we've lived through the ending of a civil war in Northern Ireland. We've had a Belfast peace process. And it's only really in the early 2000s that one began to see some of the benefits, some of the functioning of that peace process. Well, if it's taken up to 10 years in Northern Ireland, you know, how could it possibly have been achieved by the Paris Peace Conference in 1919? So to me, it makes sense to see the Paris Peace Conference in a way as the culmination of the war. And many of the cultural forces, the sense of enmity is revved up again in 1919 and has a great deal to do in many respects with the outcomes, although there's already a shifting configuration between the Allies themselves. The British predisposed once they've got what they wanted to try and moderate the French, seeing the French rather than the Germans as a problem. The second exit from the war comes after 1924, 1925. And I think that the real peacemaking process after the Great War is in the second part of the 1920s. So there are two exits from the war, and they're precisely what I was trying to pinpoint by the Janus-faced nature of 1917. Let me give a couple of concrete examples of it. Some of those politicians who've been marginalized by Clemenceau's arrival in power and by the political turbulence created by the scandals in 1917, I'm thinking of people like Malvy, the Minister of the Interior, who is pilloried by Clemenceau, Caillaux himself, they're back in office by 1924, 1926. And this is something which can only have happened because there's been a fundamental change in at least that part of the electorate's understanding of what the war entailed, what it was engaged in. Briand is an excellent example of this. Briand, who is the prime minister who's in power at the time of Verdun, he is already, by the early 1920s, moderating his views. But by 1925 to 1932, when he dies, as you know, he's the Minister for Foreign Affairs, who, in a way, because at one level, because he's always done what he did, which was to be a very good corridor politician, the conciliator, the stitching together the coalitions, he does that internationally with the Germans, and he becomes the peacemaker and a man of principle. And it's in that role that he's understood in the second half of the 1920s. So that there is a process of what I've called elsewhere cultural demobilization, but which only really starts 10 years after the war. There are two exits from the war for the French. And 1917 in retrospect, or the kind of language of peace which has emerged in 1917, or rather the language of the horror of war, which has been given an unprecedented space rhetorically in 1917, becomes in many respects a dominant language in the second half of the 1920s.
Thank you. Julian Wright from Durham. Thank you very much for your talk. I'm always very struck by, at the march on the 6th of April 1919 in honor of Jaurès, the image of the working class soldiers at the front of the march placing their croix de guerre at the foot of the bust of Jaurès, lots and lots and lots of them piling up during the course of the day. It was quite a strong thing that happened. But I wondered whether you could talk just a little bit about working class soldiers and what they thought of their identity as soldiers, whether they had any concept of the armies of the First Republic and that Republican sense of a Republican army, or what, and whether there's any sense then of them having a different identity to the soldiers that they were fighting.
Thank you very much. Just a brief comment on Jaurès, and there's also that following moment, which when I was describing the change of perceptions in 1924 with the Cartel de Gauche, and this mobilization, in fact, of a kind of form of violence, of paramilitary violence, now against the Republic, which it's felt is about to lose the peace. The thing which triggers that is the transfer, of course, as I'm sure you know, of the ashes of Jaurès to the Panthéon. The march preceded by miners from Carmeau with their pique and their helmets, but at the tail of the march, the communists and a whole group of immigrant workers, and this is the vision which sparks, in particular, the founding of the Jeunesse Patriote. So it is a kind of critical moment, but it's a very, very interesting question as to when you say working class soldiers, it's in a way a kind of problematic term in France during the First World War. So I'd distinguish very quickly between that and perhaps the larger question of whether soldiers themselves see themselves as the soldats de l'Andeux or in that tradition. As I was trying to point out, one of the effects of Durkheim rather than Danton of the division of labor is that already by 1915, certainly the skilled working class soldiers are being pulled out of the army. They're being pulled out of the front lines and sent back to the factories. And while, of course, it is the case, it depends by what you mean by working class, that many laborers or unskilled workers remained at the front as soldiers, there is a distinct shift in the social composition of the army, and it makes it very different from the British army, where if 75% of British society is kind of working class during the First World War, even with the industrial mobilization, most of the soldiers at the front are going to be working class. Whereas I believe, in a way, from 1915 on, that's not the case with the French. But the consequence of your question is that there's a very, very interesting kind of trajectory which working class soldiers, because they remain subject to military discipline, have. So often they go back to the factories, but not to the factories of the towns that they came from. They're sent by the military administration to wherever it is in France that they're needed, with the rearranged industrial geography of France during the war. They reassume a kind of working-class life. Many of them join trade unions, form new trade unions, often militant by the end of 1916. But in 1918, these are precisely the people who are being targeted by Clemenceau to be combed out, as the English would say, in the manpower shortage to go back to the front. And there you get a kind of clash between the military identity and the class identity on the part of those soldiers. And it's something which I think hasn't yet really been studied in any detail, but I just get a sense of what that entailed from reading the postal control of some of the units at the front. When these men arrive in after the May strikes of 1918, which have been waged against being combed out for the front, they're sent to the front, and there's a real sense of tension there. The soldiers who've been there all along say it's about time they came back. Ce sont des embusqués. These are shirkers who've now finally come back to do their duty at the front. But they point out that these soldiers writing in their correspondence, which is opened and read by the French military authorities, that often they seek a place in and are given a place in the specialist functions of the army behind the front. Because the division of labor, which I described, doesn't just apply to the distinction between the industrial mobilization at home and the fighting army at the front. The fighting army at the front itself becomes subject to the division of labor. You have artillery parks, you have mechanical workyards, you have railway stations, and so on and so forth. So there's a huge kind of sense of working class soldiers working as workers just behind the front, and often they're people who are skilled men in ordinary life. So it's a complex story, and one which I think hasn't yet been fully unraveled.
Questions? Sorry, I've just been given we've got 5 minutes. 5 minutes. More questions? I can ask another one.
As you wish.
Yes.
Bob Wiener, Lafayette College again.
Holmes' century of total war that lost from our historiographic consciousness, when it seems to me at least that many of the kinds of things that have been developed in the last 15 years are already there in germ that early. We lose a sense of memory and we go return to the archives and ferret it all out, or from a different discipline.
It's a good question. I don't really have an answer to it. I mean, I know that there's a whole set of questions about Aron and his intellectual profile and the ways in which at some points he was ignored and the place of a liberal intellectual of that particular colouring in the rather polarised France of the Cold War years. But you may well be right that on the issue of total war, he's somebody worth going back to. But I do think that one of the implications of trying to look for what I've described as totalizing logics, quite apart from their value of being scaled up to an international or a global way of understanding the war, is that they really mean going back to the archives and finding out exactly what these processes are. And I mean, as the first questioner suggested, I mean, trying to see, well, how is it that a notion such as cultural self-mobilization, what does that mean to the rural population of the Tarn in 1915, for example? And it seems to me that in terms of priorities, certainly for me, that's where the agenda is.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I think we need to thank Professor Horne for a great lecture.